Check, check. Let's worship Jesus in this place. Let's go ahead and stand to our feet. And let's sing this. Who breaks the power?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth? Who shakes the whole earth? With holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Come on, say this is amazing grace.
This is amazing grace.
Unfailing love.
This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. You would bear my cross. You would lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Who brings our chaos back into order?
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Oh, who rules the nations?
Who rules the nations? With truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Oh, this is amazing grace.
This is amazing grace.
It's unfailing love.
This is unfailing love.
Oh, Lord,
that you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life.
Thank you for
that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Oh, come on, we're gonna declare right now.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, we sing. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain, we sing. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love.
Thank you, Jesus.
That you would take my place. Cross. You would lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
All that you've done,
all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me, for me, for me. All that you've done for me. This is amazing grace.
Yes, it is.
Thank you, Jesus, for your amazing grace, oh God. In the splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, that all
All the earth rejoice. All the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light. The darkness tries to hide, but it trembles at his voice. It trembles at his voice. Come on, declare. And how great is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. Oh, H to H you say. H to H he stands, and time is in his hands,
and time is in his hands. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The good Godhead three in one. Oh, Father, Spirit. The lion and the lamb, the lion and the lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great, how great. How great is our God. Oh, he's a name above all names, a name above all names. You're worthy, worthy of all praise. Great is our God. Oh, it's a name above all names. You're worthy, worthy of all praise, and my heart will sing. How great is our God.
Oh, come on, church, and sing. How great is our God.
And how great is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. Oh, we'll see how great. How great is our God.
Hallelujah, let's give him praise in this place.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord, you are so good. You are great in this place. You are high and lifted up, oh God.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for this opportunity just to worship your holy name. God, you are so good to us. You have been so good to us, God, and you will continue to be so good. And Father, we just praise you for that. God, we lift up every need in this place, those that are sick. Lord, in body, Leonard and Shiggy, and a Judy, God, and a Susie, God, and Cindy and her mom. God, we lift up all of these, those that are sick. Dennis, God, you would just heal his eye complete and supernatural healing, Lord, in his body and anyone else that has been battling sickness. God, we just pray for healing. You are a miracle working God, and I pray, Lord, right now, Lord, that you would just do it in this place. We declare it. Lord, we pray for salvations in this place. God, conversions. Lord, that people, God, would be drawn into your house. Lord, they would be drawn to you, their creator, their savior, Lord. We pray right now just for something different. Lord, in this place, God, in this city, God, in this state, God, we lift up, God, we ask for peace, Lord, in our nation, God, we lift up our all those that are serving, Lord, military and police and firefighters, God, we lift them up to you, God, that you would just move, Lord, you move in this place and our lives. We give you this time. Lord, you would anoint Pastor Bill as he ministers to us. In your wonderful, wonderful name, Jesus. All of God's children said amen. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Why don't we take a minute? Why don't we just say hi to one another before we're seated?
Check, check. Amen. Good evening. How's everybody doing today? Tonight? Everybody made it through the rain, through the accident? All right. I know we've got some. Please keep Dennis in your prayers as well. He's recovering from his eye surgery. And I know that Shiggy is dealing with, pregnancy sickness and all that kind of stuff. And so anyway, a lot of stuff going on. Does anybody need a bulletin? Because that's basically our schedule. And so this Saturday, we are having a yard sale, outreach, cookout, fellowship, fun. And so that's going to start at 11. We are going to meet here at the church. I know a bunch of people are meeting here early to help set up, but we're going to be outreaching at 10 o'clock. And so we're going to be outreaching our neighborhood, and maybe we'll send some folks down to Kroger's just to get the word out that we're having a yard sale. We can talk some of our young people into making up a sign that says yard sale. And so we're going to have that this Saturday. And outreach again is at 10 o'clock. And so we're going to have a great time. We want to be a blessing to our community. That's really the whole goal and heartbeat behind. I don't know what generally, a lot of times having a yard sale is get rid of all the stuff you don't want, right? But we're not just doing that. We want to be a blessing to the community in every way that we can. And so this is part of the constant creativity that we are leaning into. And so we are wanting to be creative and do what we can to be a blessing. So I encourage you to just be a part of that on Saturday. And then Sunday, we'll be right back here at 11 o'clock and 7 o'clock hearing the Word of God. And so I encourage you to be a part of all that we're doing. I'm going to have the ushers come tonight. We're going to take our tithes and offerings. And again, I know that there was a couple accidents on the freeway. And so I'm glad everybody made it safe. But we're going to take our tithes and offerings. And so I want to encourage you just to be faithful in giving. All the ways to give are online there. Zelle, Venmo, Cash App. There's envelopes on the back of the seats here that you can put your cash in. If you're writing a check, you don't need to put it in an envelope. That's primarily so we can track everything that comes in through cash. But I encourage you to be faithful. You give. Let's believe God for great things. Amen. Heads are bowed. Eyes are closed. Aaron, why don't you lift your voice? Bless the gift and giver. Amen, amen. God bless you tonight. Go ahead and open your Bibles, Daniel chapter 11. Daniel chapter 11, I'll read this verse in just a moment. Houston, we have a problem. How many of you remember those words? Houston, we have a problem. These were the words of Jim Lovell on the evening of April 13th, 1970. Nearly 56 hours into the mission to the moon, an explosion happened aboard the spacecraft, plunged the crew into a fight for their survival. And literally within less than a minute, there was a series of system failures throughout the spacecraft. It was all at one time a monstrous failure, said one of NASA's flight controllers. It was all at one time. Anybody ever experienced that in life? All at one time, a monstrous failure. The spacecraft, and again, I was I was actually almost 6 years old. This is 3 days before my sixth birthday that this happened, April 13th, 1970. So I don't recollect all that was happening, but the spacecraft looped around the moon using its gravity to return to Earth as millions of people followed the drama on television. Eventually, the capsule splashed down in the Pacific Ocean near Tonga. And in an article headed Apollo 13, From Disaster to Triumph, the BBC science reporter wrote this: although the mission was not a success from a conventional perspective, it was a triumph of ingenuity and determination. Jim Lovell said it showed the people around the world that even if there was a great failure, it could be turned into a success. And so I'm closing out this little series that we've been doing on a willingness to fail. As you know, that was 1970, and so fast forwarding, there have been numerous space adventures, and they didn't take this failure and stop. You know what they did? They said, you know what? We're going to risk it again. We're going to try again. We're going to try, as the Irish poet said, and I said this Sunday, we're going to fail and fail again and go on failing, only next time fail better. And that's what they were determined to do. They were determined to take a risk at failing again. And obviously there was a lot that they learned. A lot of adjustments were made. But see, we live in a society that glorifies success. They glorify achievement. If you're achieved and you're successful, there's something that people look at you different. This is proven. How many of you have seen those tests where they take a homeless man, dress him in a $1,000 suit, and have him walk down the street, and everybody says, hello, hello, hello? Because people are enamored with success. However, when we look into the Word of God, we find that failure can be a powerful tool for growth and wisdom and spiritual increase. No one enjoys failure, but without the opportunity to fail, you will never experience success. Let me just say this. You don't always fail on your way to success. However, if you don't take the risk of failure, and that's what I'm saying, no one experiences success without the opportunity to fail. There's always the opportunity to fail. You know, you talk about NASA, you know, they did experience catastrophes after that. As many of us watched on television, all of these things transpire, but they continued to take the risk. And that's really what I'm talking about as a congregation, is that we would just be willing to risk. See, if you stopped failing, if you stopped the opportunity to fail, then you stopped risking. When you fail, and I know you've experienced this as an adult, I've experienced this, but when you fail, you tend to second guess yourself. You tend to say, should I do it again? Should I go that direction? Should I witness again? Whatever it may be. But I want to read Daniel chapter 11, and I'm going to just basically read this, kind of go through it. I'm going to tell you a couple stories, and then we're going to close. But my goal tonight and throughout this series is to maybe help us get out of our comfort zone, say, Lord, where am I risking? Because I just feel like faith is a risk. I feel, you know what? I feel like I preached this years ago. God is risking letting me pastor. I mean, I'm like, I know me. I know my pride. I know my tendencies. I know what I've come out of. And I've always felt that. God, you're really taking a chance here, you know? And I want, and it's through prayer and the word and your prayers for me and this church and our leadership that God is moving. So, but I want to read Daniel 11, verse 32. Those who do wickedly against the covenant, he shall corrupt with flattery. But the people who know their God shall be strong and carry out great exploits. The people who know their God shall be strong and carry out great exploits. I finished our Sunday morning message with that particular verse. And what I wanted to point out was that the people that this verse is being spoken to are still in captivity. They're still in Babylon, which was a result of their own massive failure to obey God after God constantly warned them. You know, in some ways, you know, a lot of us, you know, we come to church, we're getting built up, we're getting strengthened, we're hearing the word, faith is growing. For others, it's a warning. For others, they can hear the service or the sermon as a warning to obey or to get right or repent or live for God or whatever it may be. And so the people of Israel were continually warned by Jeremiah, the prophet, to get their heart right with God and to obey God, to cast off their idols. Remember the scripture I read to you a few weeks ago? They plugged up their ears and they shrugged their shoulder and they said, "We will not listen." That was them. That's who is now being prophesied over, that if you will know your God, you will do mighty exploits. And here is God in the midst of their failure. They're not out of their failure. They're still in captivity. They're not out of their failure. They're in the midst of it. And God is telling them, "I want to use you for great things." Never write yourself off. Never say, "God can't use me. I've done this. I've done that." God, why? Because if you will dig in and know God, even in all of our failure, will you be willing to fail again? Will you be willing to go again? Will you be willing to do it again? Step out again. Speak out again. Give again. Love again. Reach out again. Knock on a door again. Right? Whatever it may be. See, they're not like out of the woods. They're still being held as slaves. And I want you to know that Daniel, this is all in Daniel 11, but earlier in the book of Daniel, you see Daniel, he's saying this in chapter 11, right? And this is after he had risked his life praying, after he's told not to pray, and he prays anyway, and then he's delivered up to the lion's den. You know, that all makes for fascinating commentary and story, except if you're Daniel. I mean, this is real life. Are you willing to fail? Are you willing, in the world's eyes, to be cast aside, to be made unpopular, to be canceled? Because Nebuchadnezzar was doing the ultimate canceling of Daniel, and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were canceling you. But here, Daniel, after he's risked his life, delivered up to the lions, we know the story. The lions' mouths were shut. This is after Israel had witnessed Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego being saved in the fiery furnace, because They would not bow. They wouldn't bow down to the world or whatever. Whatever is going on in the world. The world's always wanting the church to bow the knee. The world is always wanting the church and the church leaders to bow their knee to what they're pushing, whatever it is. They want the church, and here's Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego saying, we will not bow our knee to what the world is pushing. And so they were then delivered up to the fire. So I know a lot you're familiar with that story, but I'm reiterating it for a reason. Because both of these stories reveal to us people who risked their lives to obey God. They risked their lives to obey God. And so in the world's eyes, when you think about it, Daniel and the three Hebrew children, they were all in a prominent position of leadership in Babylon. I mean, Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, they were the cream of the crop. That's what the Bible tells us. These were men of stature and wisdom and knowledge and personality, charisma. They had it going on. And so Nebuchadnezzar says, I'm placing you in a position of leadership in Babylon. And so here, now they are saying, we are standing for God, not for Babylon. And in the world's eyes, they are failures. They are failing. See, again, you know, the willingness to fail is only a perceived idea. Because men and women of God, obedient men and women of God, are never failures. Again, I'm saying that word failure for the sake of saying we need to risk. But see, these men were failures in the world's eyes. But what the world sees as failure, God sees as faithful. Such an odd contrast. I mean, a complete failure. Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, what are you doing? You're giving up a great position. Listen, you're giving up your future. You're giving up your finances. You're giving up your inheritance. You're giving up, you know, your all that you know, your family. You're willing to go into a fiery furnace and forget everything on this earth for what? See, what the world sees as failure, God sees as faithful. What we do as a fellowship. See, we are a part of a larger fellowship. We are a part of a fellowship called Christian Fellowship Ministries. And what we do as a fellowship lends itself to failure. You know, we're not a part of a denomination, but we're a part of other churches, other fellowship churches, if you will. But what our fellowship does is it lends itself, gives itself to the opportunity to fail all the time. We have sent out couples to pioneer churches, to break ground in new cities, to break ground in new countries over the past 50 plus years. Couples, young couples, some of them, young couples to pick up and pack up and pull out. I had to stay in the P's there. But they packed up their U-Haul and they pulled out, and some of them, they pulled their kids out of school, and some of them, you know, they left their parents behind, and some of them left other family members and churches that they served in and loved, left them behind, and they pulled out, and they went into another city, sometimes, you know, a couple miles away, sometimes a couple thousand miles away, to then arrive in a city A lot of times, like us, without a job, we had no job when we got here. That's how most couples do it, unless they get transferred and whatever it may be. That's not always the case. But they arrive in a city, they find a building, they have nobody, and they break new ground. And not all of them have succeeded. Not all of them have pioneered and raised up a church and people have gotten saved. Not all of them have stayed. Some of them stayed a year, 3 years, 5 years, and then they get redirected back into their... They don't always succeed. Many of them, and I'll put this in air quotes, many of them have failed. Pastor Warner, as I was putting this together, Pastor Warner, who is the senior pastor in our church in Tucson, Arizona, and this is the place that we're getting ready to go to the Bible conference in a couple of weeks. He was a failure. His first church, he was a failure. Again, let me just, if you bear with me, give you a little bit of the synopsis and some of it we saw on our conference video. Some of it Pastor Warner has told me about just in conversation. But back in the 70s, we were part of a denomination called Foursquare. And what Foursquare did is all over the West Coast, really, it was primarily West Coast, they would have what they called missions. And it was usually, you know, a couple of ladies would start a Bible study, start a food program, have a building, and then they would have somebody from Foursquare Bible College come in and take over and start the church. That's generally what they did. And so there was a gentleman who called Pastor Mitchell and asked him in 1972, said, "Do you have a couple that could come and take over the mission in Kearney, Arizona?" Some of you will have to get out your GPS and really look hard for Kearney, Arizona. A little speck of dust on the map. And Pastor Mitchell sent Pastor Harold Warner and his wife, Mona. At the time, Pastor Warner was 22 years old, and his wife, Mona, was the ripe old age of 18 years old. When they arrived in Kearney, Arizona, they immediately found out that there was a parade. So, hey, everybody loves a good parade. Every pioneer church, oh, this is a great way to reach the city and get to know everybody and, you know, do what they do. But Pastor Warner, remember, we've got over 3,000 churches now. He was the first. So there was no, like, who went before him? Nobody. He's 22 years old, been saved for 2 years. Mona, they had been married for months. They got married when she was 17 and a half. She always emphasizes the half. But they're in Kearney, Arizona. They find out there's a parade. You know, they've just arrived. They pull a little thing behind them, a little cart that had some chairs and sound system and just some things that they brought with them. And they brought a bullhorn. So Pastor Warner grabs his bullhorn. They don't have a float in the parade. They don't have permission to be in the parade. But he gets at the very end of the parade. And as everything's going by, all the people lined up, little cowboy town. And here's Pastor Warner. You got Pastor Warner was, and this is a true story. Pastor Warner's from Massachusetts in the Boston area. He went to Prescott. He was went there with some friends, and he was a heroin addict. Had long hair. He had hepatitis C. You know, when he got saved, radically saved, back in the 70s, they said, we're going to have a baptism. He said, I don't have any other clothes. They said, well, he said, I'll get baptized naked. And they're like, well, we don't really do that, Harold. You know, it's not really. And that's a true story. He confirmed it last conference. Huh? Yeah, he confirmed in his podcast, yeah. So that's Pastor Warner. But anyway, he ended up getting baptized and got his clothes wet, thank God. But so Pastor Warner, I mean, Raw, we're talking Raw, 22 years old. He's at the end of this parade, and he's got his bullhorn, and he's just preaching, probably giving his testimony. I want to get baptized naked. But God, you know, whatever he said, I don't know what he said. I don't know what he was saying. But he's preaching the gospel to all of these people. And the parade route is going into the middle of town. And he's got his bullhorn. And he's preaching. He's giving it everything he's got. And he told me that he looked up in front of them. And the guy that invited them to actually come there was standing in the doorway of his house. And he said they caught eyes. And the guy went. The guy called Pastor Mitchell. And said, this isn't going to work. So Pastor Warner and Sister Mona packed up, and she had one of the sisters from the church come and help her friend from the Prescott Church. They loaded up, and her and Mona went ahead of Pastor Warner. He had one of his friends, Ron Jones, come, and they gathered up all the stuff. And as they are driving back from Kearney, Arizona to Prescott, they hit a patch of road that I think was wet or oily or whatever it was, and they ran off the road, and the car flipped. I don't remember how many times. But when it stopped, Ron Jones looks at Pastor Warner, asks him how he is, and Pastor Warner said, I can't move my legs. And so Ron Jones gets out of the car, no cell phone, no nothing, runs back to where they came from, gets help. And many of you know the story. Pastor Warner ends up in traction. He broke his back, and he became paralyzed from the waist down. And Ron Jones did suffer back injury as well, but nothing permanent. Everyone was troubled at what happened. And Pastor Mitchell told me this. He's passed away now, but he told me years ago. He said that everybody told me, what are you doing? This is on you. You sent Harold and Mona out. What are you doing? You said you heard from God to pioneer churches. And so Pastor Mitchell incredibly didn't flinch. The very next service, he told me, he said the very next service, and I know that he shared this in other times, but we were driving together for a period of time, and he told me, he said the very next service, I pulled an altar call. And I said, how many of you couples would stand up and come forward to take Harold and Mona's place? And he said they had some 9-10 couples stand up that Sunday morning and come to the front saying, we will take their place. Here's Pastor Warner's in traction. He's in the hospital in Phoenix, Arizona. And people are getting ministered to while he's there. 9 months later, he's in traction. 9 months later, he gets out of traction. And he tells Pastor Mitchell, I need to pioneer. This is my calling. I'm called to preach. I'm not called to sit in a church and do that. I am called to preach. Others, yes, are called to be here and support and be pillars, and I understand that. But Mona and I are called to preach the gospel. So Pastor Warner, literally, how many ever months later it was, November 1973, he and Mona are sent to Tucson, Arizona, to pioneer a church, just him and Mona, him in his wheelchair and his bullhorn. Took his bullhorn with him. And there's so many stories Pastor Warner has told throughout the years. Even Mona has shared throughout the years of those early days. What am I saying? That they were willing to fail again. There was no guarantee. See, we look at it now, 52 years later now, and we see Pastor Warner has pioneered and discipled couples, and you know, I've shared this, out of their church alone, they have sent out over 500 couples to pioneer churches. And a number of those churches are what we in our fellowship call leadership churches. And what a leadership church simply means is that that leadership church has at least 25 couples of their own pioneered out of that church. I think 7 of the couples Pastor Warner has pioneered out have leadership churches. Someone said, out of the 3,000 churches that our fellowship has, Pastor Warner is responsible for a third of them. So I'm talking about a willingness to fail. It wasn't a willingness to succeed. It was, I need to preach. I don't know what's going to happen. Folks, literally, he stood in the high school, outside the high school with a bullhorn, preaching, and people were throwing rocks at him. This is 1973, 74. By 1979, he's got 600 people in his church. He's got churches out pioneering. But there's no guarantee of that. It was just, I'm willing to fail again. See, we're able to look fast forward at all that God has done, the mighty exploits that God has done through Pastor Warner and Mona. But there was no guarantee that God was going to move. It was a willingness to fail, and Pastor Mitchell took a risk. He bypassed all of the criticism. I'm telling you, Pastor Mitchell told me, man, they were on him. Families were on him. Mona's mom lived in Prescott. They were on him. What have you done? Pastor Mitchell said, I believe this is God. He wants us to pioneer churches and win the world. See, not everything goes great, goes the way we want it. But there's a willingness. That's what I said. Our fellowship lends itself to failure. We didn't know what was going to happen when we moved here 10 years ago. We didn't know if anybody was going to come, anyone was going to get saved. We didn't know. We just said, you know what? We're willing to take a risk. Let me give you 5 ways to deal with failure. We know that Romans 8:28, all things work together for the good of those who love God, are called according to his purpose. Philippians 4:3, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. These are just a couple of verses to please always encourage yourself. Number one, you have to adjust your perspective. You cannot make failure an identity. Failure cannot become your identity. It cannot become the way you process life. You have to adjust your perspective. Why? Because failure is an event, not a lifestyle. Failure is something that happened and happens. It's not a lifestyle. You cannot look at all of life and chalk yourself up to being a failure. It cannot become your identity. Adjust your perspective. Number two, accept the failure. Accept it. You know, when my wife and I went out to pioneer our first church in the metropolis of Little Rock, California, population 3,000, little bedroom community outside of Los Angeles County. You know, we were there a year and a half, almost 2 years. You know, I never viewed it as a failure. I thought, you know, our marriage got strengthened. People got saved. You know, when we left, there were 50 people in the church. Another pastor took the church over. You know, but a lot of people, when we came back, they would mention, that it was a failure. They would say that to me. We were all young. We didn't know how to talk to each other. We didn't know. Oh, you guys failed. Oh, thanks. We didn't know how to even be kind, like in, you know, a kind, you just don't say that. But what we did is we accepted that, you know what, this wasn't all that we wanted it to be. So we learned. We grew. So what you do is you talk through your failure. You do not internalize it. You don't let it become a part of your personality. Listen, do not isolate yourself after failure. People that isolate themselves when they fail, they treat it like they're the only ones who've ever failed. It's like, listen, join the human race, man. We've all, you know, falling short in whatever it may be. But what you have to do is you just got to embrace it, accept it, and say, you know what? It is what it is. I'm going to learn. I'm going to try again. And I may fail again, but I'm going to learn. I'm going to make an adjustment. And I'm going to try again. Number three, analyze your failure. Learn, adjust, try again. Learn, adjust, try again. John Dewey said, failure is instructive. And here's all I would say, is if you don't learn from your failure, you have wasted the failure. If you don't learn from your failure, you've wasted it. When you fail, get what you paid for. Don't be cheated when you fail. I'm telling you, analyze it. Where did I go wrong? What did I do wrong? Was it all me? Was it all them? Was it both of us? What? Is it God? Is it timing? Is it the devil? Right? You look at it, you learn, you adjust, and you go for it again. Don't get cheated. Number four, adjust your game plan. Like anyone who goes into battle and loses, they adjust their approach and then they attack again. They adjust their approach and they attack again. You'll hear announcers in sporting events from time to time. They'll say things like, Coach Dan is really good at making in-game adjustments. In other words, they're getting pounded. And in the middle of a game, they'll make an adjustment and all of a sudden they'll turn the tide. And what they call that is an in-game adjustment. They might have been losing 20-3 in the first 5 minutes of the basketball game, but they'll call timeout and because he sees something. Here's what we need to do. And all of a sudden, before you know it, it's 20-15. Then it's 25-20, and all of a sudden they're back in the game. See, you adjust your game plan. Other announcers might say, I wonder what adjustments the coach is going to make at halftime. See, this is the beauty of halftime, is they can go in, they can look at game, the film, and they can go, okay, da-da-da-da-da, yada-da-dee, and all of a sudden they've adjusted it, they go back out completely different. The only thing you got to remember is everybody's making adjustments. In a game, everybody's adjusting. What you got to do is you got to adjust your game plan. Don't allow yesterday's failure to stop today's opportunities. Do not allow yesterday's failures to stop today's opportunities. Folks, listen, as believers in Jesus Christ, as followers of Christ, as those that are submitted to His will and His plan, He is going to give us opportunities every day. Opportunities to get our own hearts right. Opportunities to speak into the lives of others. Opportunities to, you know, step into destiny, to step out in faith, whatever it may be. Don't allow yesterday's failure to stop today's opportunities. Don't even allow that voice of failure to have a voice today. And number five, attach yourself to others. Don't do life alone. Whether you're succeeding or whether you're falling on your face, don't do life alone. You know, I love this verse in Luke chapter 22, verse 32. I read this whole verse to you on Sunday. I kind of played it out in a little dramatic fashion. Jesus looks at Peter and said, Satan's asked for you. Remember that verse? Well, here's what Jesus tells Peter. When you return, strengthen your brothers. When you return, attach yourself to others. Don't isolate yourself. Don't do this alone, Peter. Don't go at it alone. Because they're going to need strength. You're going to need strength. You're going to need each other. This is not a short-term game plan. This is long-term. And Jesus instructs him, connect yourself to one another. So let me just finish and encourage you. Failure is not sin. Now, I'm not talking about sin. Some people might call sin failure. I failed. But no, you sinned. I'm not talking about sin that needs to be repented of and needs to be forgiven and delivered and cleansed. I'm not talking about sin. I'm talking about living a life of faith and sometimes failing. Living a life of risk and sometimes coming up short and having to step back, analyze it, adjust, and go again. That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about our life in destiny, living a life of faith. You know, when Jesus called Peter out onto the water, Peter was actually safer on the water than he was in the boat. Why? Because Jesus wasn't in the boat. Jesus was in the storm. See, every storm is not a failure. But see, we, you know, remember, we're a generation of success. We're a generation of achievement. And so when we have a storm, what did I do? Where did I go wrong? Da da da. You know, there was not, it was in the storm. But see, here's the deal. Sometimes we want everything to be in place before we step on that invisible bridge. Right? Remember that story Sunday, right? Right? We want everything to line up. Make sure this is covered, that's covered. Listen, Peter is looking eyeball to eyeball with Jesus. And he sinks. He had everything he needed, and he still sunk. But what happens is, as Peter is sinking, what did he do? He didn't say, "Oh, Lord, I failed you. Never mind. I guess I'll just die." No, he said, "Lord." And then Jesus reaches out his hand, as he always does, because Jesus never writes you off. You know, Jesus just says, "Oh, ye of little faith." He didn't look at Peter and go, "Peter, what is your problem, bro? I was standing right here, man. Don't you even know me?" He didn't do that. He didn't lecture Peter. He said, "Peter, you need to remember that faith will get you through failure. The Bible says that it is impossible to please God without faith. Faith means risk. You didn't need faith to sit in that chair today. Why? Because it's a chair. You're trusting. There's just not a lot of faith. I could probably jump up on it and stand on it and jump up and down. And you know, it's like I'm not, you know, it doesn't take a lot of faith to do that. But there are things in life that there's no guarantee. There are things that God is calling us to that have the risk of failure. Are you willing to fail? Are you willing to step out and just say, "God, fail or succeed, I'm obeying you"? Nebuchadnezzar, right? Remember the verse. Our God is going to save us. But even if he doesn't, we are not bowing down. Even if we die in the fire, we're going to die faithful. See, it's impossible to please God without faith. In 1832, he lost his first bid for a Senate seat in the Illinois General Assembly. In 1843, he failed to secure the nomination for Congress. In 1848, he did not receive an appointment to the General Land Office after serving a single term in Congress. In 1854, although elected to the Illinois legislature, he declined the seat to focus on a U.S. Senate race, which he lost. In 1856, he failed to win the nomination for vice president at the Republican National Convention. In 1858, he lost the U.S. Senate race to Stephen Douglas, despite gaining national prominence through his debates. Despite these setbacks, in 1860, Abraham Lincoln was voted as the 16th president of the United States. All of these setbacks, at any one of them, he could have said, "Forget it. I'm done. No more. I've got better things to do. I've got a wife. I've got children. I've got stuff going on in my life." In all of these setbacks, Abraham Lincoln continued to refine. See, that's what failure can help you do. It can help you refine. He refined his political skill and ideals, and it eventually led to his election of President of the United States. See, we can allow the enemy a voice, or we can allow God a voice. When we fall short, when we fail, when we, whatever it may be, come up empty, when we stepped out, it didn't happen. Folks, putting all of this together, I thought, you know, Lord, I could just stand up there and just talk about all my failures, but I'm not going to do that. Because there's so many things that even in ministry, you fail at, like preaching a sermon that goes, it just isn't, boom. And so what do you do? Well, number one, you don't base your sermon on how people respond. Then how many people came to the altar? How many people were crying? How many people? I used to do that. And it was a bad mistake. Because you'd leave services like, I guess. You got to learn from that. And say, God, I am doing this for you. I am doing this, really. I mean, I'm not saying this as semantics. I'm doing this for an audience of one. And I'm praying that the Holy Spirit takes what's being said and somehow helps you, strengthens you, builds you up in your most holy faith so that you can, in whatever, listen, whatever you step into, whatever area of faith, whatever area of ministry, whatever area of work, finances, family, whatever it is you step into, that you say, God, whether I fail or whether I succeed, I am going to be faithful to you. Whether I am falling short, and in my opinion, everybody, every pioneer pastor who's ever went out and picked up his family and moved into another location, every one of them are successes, in my opinion. In my opinion, there, anybody who has tried to preach the Word of God, tried to witness and minister and go door to anybody that's done, man, that's powerful. And I want to encourage you to not be afraid. Don't give in to fear. The fear of failure. Don't give in to that. Say, no, 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 God, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to please you by believing you to do great things through me. So listen, we're going to pray tonight. I want you to bow your heads with me. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed for a couple of minutes here tonight. Thank you for your time. And anyone that's watching, thank you for watching tonight. But you're here tonight, and maybe God is dealing with you to surrender your heart to Him. To give your life to Jesus. To say, yes, Lord, I surrender to you. I'm going to give my life to you. I've been living my life how I want to live, doing what I want to do, acting how I want to act. But today I'm going to surrender my life to you. And you're sitting there and God's dealing with you. You're watching tonight. God's dealing with you. And you would say, yes, pray for me. I want to surrender my life tonight. Would you pray? All over this sanctuary watching tonight, God is dealing with you, speaking to you. And you say, yes, I want to surrender to Jesus, or I want to rededicate my life. I want to up it. I want to up my commitment to Him. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I'm ready to say yes to Him. Would you lift your hand? Let me pray for you. All over this sanctuary tonight. And watching tonight, God is dealing with you. Anyone here? Thank you, Jesus. Well, I want to pray a very simple prayer for you tonight, all of you that are here and watching. Then we'll have just a short Q&A if anybody has any questions. But I just really want to pray into this. Father, I'm asking, God, that you would move by the power of your presence and your Spirit. God, in our lives, you would help us. God, your people, your church, your body. Help us to be the hands and feet. Help us, Lord, to be those that will step up and step out. God, and we wouldn't allow fear or failure, the fear of failure. God, we wouldn't allow any of the obstacles to be able to silence us, to stifle us. But God, we would be those that would step out and say, God, whether I fall on my face or whether I'm able to continue to run, I am going to be faithful. Because I know, Lord, even if I fail, again and again, Lord, If I'm stepping out in faith and falling on my face, you will pick me up. You won't let me stay down. And I pray your blessing upon each one of us as we are willing to lay it on the line for your glory. And Lord, if we've failed in the past, at whatever it may be, I pray you would help us to just take a step back. We would learn. We would adjust. We would try again. I pray your blessing rest on this people, God. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Well, listen, I want to have just, if anybody's got any questions, we'll have a mic. John's going to sprint up here and check. Yeah. If anybody's got any questions, just, or comments, whatever. You're more than welcome to, you know, comments, questions about the willingness to fail, willingness to step out, whatever it may be. Any questions? If not, we can close in prayer. But if you got a question, anybody? Yep, Aaron.
I'll ask something for you and Miss Kim. You know, you guys have been in ministry for over 30 years. What has been like an encouragement for you to continue to, for both of you to continue on pressing on with, even amongst, like you said, you were young and they said, oh, you failed. Well, I mean, you might have taken that to heart. Right. So like, what's been something for you all where you guys have said, okay, even if we do fail or we have failed, we're going to keep pressing.
If that makes sense. Yeah, that's good. If you have something off the top of your head.
Yeah. Well, I think Little Rock was a little bit different for me because when this one lady said, how does it feel to be a failure? And I said, I failed? I didn't even know because it wasn't our decision to go home.
Right.
It was Pastor Rob's. He wanted Billy to be the worship leader again. So I didn't, we had 50 people in a year and a half. I don't know. People were getting saved. To me, that's cool. You know,
yeah.
And I was working for the police department, driving 75 miles.
One way.
Mondays and Tuesdays back and forth, you know. So I felt like we did our best, you know. And that's good enough. So it didn't really penetrate my heart. And she did come up and apologize. But it's because it was a new thing. People just don't know how, like you said, to communicate. You don't say that because, number one, you could be wrong. But number two, it's just not a cool thing to say.
Yeah.
Yeah. It just is like, but I think we were all pretty young. You know, but I think it's just your perspective. It's like what you're saying. I was like, Pastor Warder always says, he's in a wheelchair, he's an amputee, he's had cancer twice. I mean, I could go on and on and on and on and on about Pastor Warder. He would always say, you never quit. Not you never fail, you just never quit.
Yeah.
And sometimes if I ever feel like quitting, I hear Pastor Warder go, Kim. Yeah, I know. Yeah, so it's very simple. We just stay on course.
Yeah, and I think for me, what we refuse to do is disconnect. We stayed connected. And we stayed connected to one another, but we stayed connected to the vision of winning the world for Jesus. We didn't disconnect from that. That's why we're still here. We're not still here because we agree with everything we've seen throughout the 40 years of, we agree with everybody. We agree with let's win the world for Jesus. That's why we're still here. That's what has encouraged us. We're a little bit we're a little rebellious for the vision. Like we want to see people get saved. And sometimes we seem obnoxious about it because it's like we want to see people get saved. We want to see people come to know Jesus. We want to do everything we can do to you know, in our power and what we can do to, you know, we want everybody else to do it too. And so, you know, I mean, like I said, but I think that's the encouragement, is that we're linked to something bigger than what we see. You know, when you're linking your heart, like we've tried to do, as imperfect as we are, but we've tried to do it the last 30 years, we link our heart to winning the lost. We link our heart to God. You know, when we link our heart to loving the church, you know, Jesus loves the church. It's his body. He better love the church, right? It's his body. He wants his body healthy. And so when we link our hearts to that, then we link our heart to God. And so I think there's an encouragement. There's a lot of encouragement there. I mean, through all of, you know, discouragement. But again, a lot of it, like Kim said, is perspective. You know, and I think continuing to pray as well, you know, Aaron, to answer your question too, keeping a constant prayer life and just staying in the Word. But again, staying connected, I think, has been a big, big thing for us. You know, when we got redirected, that's what they call it, when you're taken out of a church and brought back to the mother church, you're redirected. And so we were the first couple in Santa Monica redirected back in 1993. And so we were redirected. And so everybody's like, oh, what did they do? What did they do wrong? You know? And so there was kind of a stigma around getting redirected. And so what I had to make a decision in my young life, I had to make a decision. When I get back into Santa Monica, I'm going to go all out. I'm going to support Pastor Rob. I'm going to submit. I'm going to do everything I can do, you know. And so, you know, there are things that we've had to do that are intentional as well, like not absorb. How's it feel to fail? Like, Kim's like, I don't know. Right? Yeah, so anyway, great question. Thanks. Yeah. Any other questions? Yep, Tara.
This might be hard. I don't know, but so, what advice would you give on like how to decipher when things just seem to be going wrong, and that isn't always an indication that you're not doing the right thing. I mean, it could be an indication right. That the enemy, you know, like you said, it's the enemy. But how do you know when it's like, this just really isn't the right fit, and or I just need to keep pressing through all of these obstacles till we get to the other side. You know, like, how do you know? I know the Holy Spirit has to lead.
That's
that,
good. Well, I think that, you know, as a couple, we've got to talk. You know, you and Mike can talk and get his perspective, and then you can get another set of eyes on it. You know, bring someone else into it, explain the situation, and get their perspective. But what I would say is, any perspective that's going to come, it should have some kind of scriptural balance to it. You know, but sometimes you have to step back and you have to go, okay, I need to make an adjustment here. You know, and then we've got to step out in faith and maybe go another direction or whatever it may be. But, you know, you don't, like I said, like with Peter, when you come back, don't stay. You need to go to the church. You need to get to your brethren and you need to be with them. And I think that's so important, to stay connected. And but a lot of times, because the Bible says there's wisdom in the multitude of counsel. But again, I will encourage you, be careful who's counseling you, you know, because, you know, you don't want, you know, somebody who's selling a product to counsel you against all the other products, you know, and push their product, right? You want to get a balanced counsel, if you will. And so I think that's important, depending on what it is. I mean, you know, whatever it may be. But that would be my advice to anybody who feels like, yeah, we're kind of stuck in the mud here. What do we do? And, you know, bring another set of eyes, because it may not be as bad as you're seeing it. right? Or it may be. It may be like, okay, the reason you're stuck in the mud is because it's muddy, right? Or it could be, wow, you look like, you know, I mean, I've said this to people. They're beating themselves up. I'm like, wow, you seem great to me. I mean, you're making such a difference in people's lives. And you know what I mean? So I think getting another perspective, if you're married, staying connected to each other in it and talking it out and looking at it. But that would be, if that makes sense, that's what I would say. Yeah.
Yeah. All of this reminds me of a book I'm reading called Divine Wilderness.
Oh, yeah.
Because no, I'm obviously not finished with it, but just the beginning of it, because all of your risks, you take a risk, and it's not, like you said, it's not really failing, but it could be, you may feel like, I mean, I remember people that would get sent back because I worked at the church, and they felt like a failure,
yeah.
And they needed encouragement,
yeah.
You know, not telling people, saying, you know, you failed, you know, you did this.
Right.
I mean, obviously, you stepped out, you know, like you said, you left, moved. I mean, you guys have moved many times and probably a lot of other people. But I've been reading Adam's book, and it reminded me of that.
Yeah.
All of your wilderness experiences are not bad. I mean,
yeah.
It's a learning process, you know,
yeah.
In that wilderness, because you can grow in that time. So I've just...
Yeah, that's very good.
I would encourage you to read the book.
Yeah, well, Father's Day gift, so. Yeah, so. Yeah. Any other thoughts, questions? Amen. Okay, so we're going to close in prayer. I appreciate, again, your time, your faithfulness. Let's go ahead and stand to our feet. We will be here Saturday. Hopefully there's no rain Saturday. Yeah, I don't know if anybody's looked at the weather. I'm looking at it right now. It looks great to me. So we're going to have a great time. Free hot dogs, chili, coleslaw. I think we got coleslaw. Did you say coleslaw? Yeah, coleslaw, Harry. Yeah, he said he makes a good coleslaw. I make a coleslaw. I'm not the one. You are. Yeah, we're going to. You're going to make this coleslaw. I'll make the chili. But we're going to, I'm going to divert, is that the right word? Deploy your coleslaw. Deploy. Military here. Are we still live streaming? People like, what are they doing there? Hey, we're just family. We're having a great time. So we'll be here 10 o'clock Saturday outreach, and then the whole yard sale again. But it's not just going to be like door-to-door. We're going to go to Kroger. We're going to try to get the word out, make some signs up, and let people know we're here, and be a blessing to our community. And then Sunday, again, we'll be back here. So let's bow our heads this evening. I appreciate you. Appreciate all that God is doing and all that God is going to do. Amen. We are looking forward to all that God is going to do. So heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Harry, why don't you lift your voice and seal us tonight as we go? God bless you.